Hi guys, I'm Julie from the Beta Group. You know about the Beta Group, of course, the largest community of tech entrepreneurs, startups in Belgium. And for first talk here, I'm with Omar Mahout, who's an entrepreneur, but also the specialist of the Belgian startup ecosystem. And today he's going to present us his new studies about what's going on, of course, in Belgium and an update on the Belgium landscape, but also if you guys want to go abroad and to give you some tips to do so and to be prepared if you want to go to the States or any other countries in Europe. Hi, Omar. Good to see you here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure and honor to be here at Beta Group tonight. So my name is Omar Mahout. In short, what I'm doing is very simple. I eat, I drink, I sleep startups. And today I'm very proud to share for the first time a study I did about how to go abroad, what are the strong and the weaker points of our ecosystem. And the premier is for Beta Group, the biggest tech startup community in Belgium.
Thank you.
You'd like to dive into it, Julie?
Yes, let's go.
Excellent. So the B-Tech startups, the good, the bad, and the ugly. First of all, let's position Belgium globally. Where do we stand? If you look from the size of the ecosystem, the number one place for startups, the Valhalla, if you like, is in Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley, by far, I believe you live there, so you know it pretty well, has between 15 and 19,000 startups and scale-ups.
Yeah.
It's the capital of tech globally. If you look to Europe, the first and biggest city we have is London. London has around 5,000 startups and scale-ups. We call it Silicon Roundabout.
Mm-hmm.
The second city might be a surprise for a lot of people, but it's Paris.
Good.
Paris indeed has a very mature, upcoming emerging ecosystem. A bit smaller than London, yet very much focused and doing very, very well in the last couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
The third city is Berlin. Interesting, because Berlin is much smaller than London, much smaller than Paris,
mm-hmm.
yet it's in number three in Europe.
Yeah, very dynamic, a lot of creativity.
Indeed.
And
indeed.
Free minds, yeah.
Absolutely. And Berlin is not Germany. It's a very consumer-oriented B2C environment. It's okay. Not like the same of the ecosystem in Germany itself. But indeed, it's quite emerging. If you compare Belgium to the Netherlands, our neighbors, they brand themselves as Startup Delta. It's the whole region between Amsterdam, Den Haag, Eindhoven. It has around 3,000, 3,500 startups and scale-ups.
Okay.
So that's the landscape globally and in Europe.
Okay, good.
Let's focus on Belgium.
Yeah, what about Belgium here?
If you look to Belgium, we have around 3,500 startups.
Wow, what a map.
Indeed. It's about 40% of the whole ecosystem has been mapped out. It's around 2 years and a half of work, actually, that I'm doing every day.
Yeah, I know.
It's horrible, but somebody has to do it, right?
You're really focusing on that. And so we can see that it's pretty much balanced with Brussels, Antwerp.
That's correct.
Bruges, Ghent a lot, yeah.
Indeed. It's indeed concentrated in around three major cities.
Yeah.
Brussels is the number one by far.
Yes.
Then we see Ghent and Antwerp as the second cities.
Mm-hmm.
One way to look into that is the triangle here gives you that almost 50% is around these three cities.
Okay, yeah.
But you can see it from a different point of view. You can say, okay, if you take Walloon Brabant and Flemish Brabant together and Brussels, and you also have 50%.
Oh, wow.
So that's another way of looking at the same thing.
Good.
So the number of cities, Levenhulme, Wavre, Nivelles, Leuven, which are really adding to the ecosystem as well.
Okay, so giving the proportion of French-speaking people and Dutch-speaking people, it's pretty much equal, we
indeed.
Can say.
Indeed. Indeed. I mean, the danger of the map here is like, oh, Flanders is doing very well. That's one view of it, right? Reality is, from my point of view, both Flanders and Wallonia are really below the level they should be. Only Brussels is doing better than we expect.
Okay.
So that's the one thing.
Yeah.
Then you can say, okay, so we have this triangle here, which is more focused to the north of the country. But you can also say, circle around Brussels, right? The Brabant, which was like the country historically, mm-hmm. is the most innovative in the country.
Fantastic.
And there, I think, being Belgium, not looking into the division of who speaks French and Flemish, it's really our strength is to look into that together.
Okay.
Nobody, not Flanders, not Wallonia, not even Brussels on itself, can be a tier one player in Europe. Together, we have a chance.
Okay.
As one ecosystem.
Yeah.
And you lived in San Francisco and in Silicon Valley. It's like, what, 1 hour to drive down from San Francisco to San Jose? One hour and a half?
Yeah, absolutely, with no traffic.
But the same in Belgium. I mean, the
correct, that's true.
The valley is a region, it's not a city.
Yeah,
right?
It's really close to each other,
correct.
All the cities.
So you can look at it as a region, as a valley, if you like.
Yeah.
Don't forget San Francisco has less number of citizens living there, population, than Brussels, smaller than Brussels.
So if we work even closer together, so we have a good chance to move forward and maybe
that's
explore.
Correct. I do believe spaces. That if Belgium works together as an ecosystem, we can be a tier two. Not a tier one, not Berlin, not London or Paris, but you can be like Stockholm, for instance. You can be that level.
Nice.
That would be really nice, right?
Okay.
But we have to think as a single ecosystem, not as everybody has his own little thing.
I love that.
I'm sure you do. And I think you as a community builder are really making a part of that to make that happen, to be like one community acting as one ecosystem.
Yeah.
So that's the future.
And the union make the force, right?
Yeah, it's our national
it's anthem.
True.
Yeah.
It's absolutely true. And people forget that Silicon Valley is a region as well. Small cities than Belgium. I mean, San Jose is smaller than Brussels. So we really have a chance to do something around that. So that's the map of Belgium. Now, very interesting graph, I think, actually, is if you look to the number of startups, foundation, by year, you see two big peaks. One in 2010. One in 2014.
Correct.
When did Beta Group start?
2008.
Oh, really? It's an early adopter, eh? So you're for sure part of this trend as well, to create awareness, help people. I think don't underestimate that. It's all this community we have around startups. So you're really part of that movement. Now, 2010 is the year that there was no threshold in technology anymore to be a startup. I.e., you don't have to buy an expensive server, 50,000 euros, or an Oracle database. Everything could be in the cloud, with mobile. You can have open source software, have your own database, which is free. So actually, anyone who could program and has a laptop can really be a startup. So that's 2010. The second thing, 2010 is the year that the movie came out, The Social Network, about Mark Zuckerberg.
Yeah.
It shows to people like, hey, you can really build a global company out of your bedroom. It's important to create that kind of awareness. 2014, the second peak, is really like the acceleration program start to kick in. The last 18 months before that, starting to launch everywhere in Belgium. The biggest number is in Brussels, then Flanders, and then in Wallonia. It's, think about it like startups are looking for gold, they're gold seekers, right? Unfortunately, the majority don't find gold, right? Like in a gold rush. And then you always have people come there and offering services, spades and whatever you need to, you know, to find the gold. So 2014 is the year you can have co-working space, mentors, even some money and subsidizing grants, some investments. So there was no excuse anymore to be a tech startup. Anyone who can program, at least can start a startup.
Okay.
There's a second peak.
And the system got organized.
Indeed. So we can really talk about these last 4 years, I believe, an ecosystem. In my view, you first have a community, then you have an ecosystem.
But it's very late because it's like, well, in proportion, yes and no, after 2010, so 4 years after the ecosystem got structured.
Yeah.
And so now 2016, 2 years later, so we should be booming here.
You're right, we should be even booming. In reality, actually, 2015 was a bit less than 2014, was a bit less, but it's still very high in there. However, this is the number of startups. What you don't see here is the improvement in quality. They get bigger, they become scale-ups in there. So it's another element you don't see in the graph. In my opinion, and that's not because I'm sitting here with Beta Group tonight, is the creation of Beta Group here helped really to kick off before the ecosystem was there.
Nice.
You need a community first before you can have an ecosystem. It came only later. So as a pioneer, you're part of the Belgian history for the startup community and ecosystem.
And that is thanks to Jean de Rilly, who who was yes. The founder indeed. Of the Beta Group with yes. the idea. So, absolutely. Yeah, thank you, Jean.
It needs one person to start a revolution, only one. Yes. Here we are, we have one in Belgium. I think that's great. So that's the founding year. Look a bit further. See something very interesting. 2/3 of our startups are in business to business. Only 1/3 is in consumer-oriented businesses. Mm-hmm. It's the exact opposite of Silicon Valley. Well, you have 2 out of 3 are consumer-oriented, and only 1/3 is B2B. So that makes our ecosystem different. Mm-hmm. Question is, why is that? Mm-hmm. A number of reasons. One of them is we are, as Belgium, in the middle of the blue banana. It means, if you look to Europe, that we are really center of the most diverse industrial environment in the world. We'll have a slide about it later on, so that's a key thing to remember. It also means that if you're in B2B, perhaps Europe might be a good position. In terms of industry, the US outsourced to China, has less industry, less expertise, less diverse. It's quite oriented towards other things. So business-to-business startups might be very good to stay in Belgium.
Okay, is it the same for the other countries, Germany, France? It's also B2B, more oriented?
That was my assumption. Last year, yeah. when I was focusing on Belgium and the Netherlands in terms of data, I assumed that the rest of Europe, Western Europe, would be the same. That, I think, is wrong. There I had the wrong assumption. Never trust assumptions. Yeah. I looked into 2 months of data, January, February, in terms of venture capital. Every company in Europe that gets at least $1 million, I put there as a scale-up, and I looked to where it came from, what they're doing. Mm-hmm. It turns out that the country with the highest number of B2B companies that raised money mm-hmm. in Europe, Belgium.
Wow, okay.
By far.
So really business-oriented.
Correct.
So is it more like a SaaS business oriented?
Indeed, it's SaaS is the number one in terms of the model, but also the application domain that they're focusing on, it's often really in the B2B space. You see in the next slide what kind of business we're talking about.
Okay.
So what you see here, Julie, is the top 5 industries in Belgium. Number one is health tech and care tech. Not a surprise. Because we have a really mature health ecosystem. So correct. We can do something here.
Yeah.
So it's the number one. So the innovation happens really in that level. It's the same in the rest of Europe. This is not a big surprise. It's also the top 5 in the rest of Europe. Also maybe in the US, I don't know. But for Europe, yes, you see that. The thing with health tech is, it's a very local thing. Because the laws and the regulations are different for every country. Mm-hmm. So these kind of startups tend to be local oriented. Not going always global.
That's true, but in the States as well, each single state have their own system.
I didn't know that. You know? Yeah, on a state level even.
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's really tricky to go into health.
You have to be careful.
Yeah.
You can also see that 1/3 of our capital comes from outside Belgium, venture capital, except for health tech.
1/3?
1/3 for the whole ecosystem.
Okay.
Comes from outside Belgium, which is a good thing,
yeah.
right? But for health tech, it's not the case. It's almost 100% local money. Because an external investor wants to see something going global or mm-hmm. European. While this is local oriented, it's not because it works in Belgium, it can work somewhere else. Because regulations, the way they're getting money back from the government maybe. Mm-hmm. So it's a very local oriented business, if you like.
Okay.
That's the first thing. Second is edtech mm-hmm. around CRM, sales and marketing. Interesting, because if you think about it, we're not like a marketing-oriented country compared to the US. But the fact that marketing becomes online, becomes software-driven, of course also gives a chance for local startups to create something there. Mm-hmm. Very often, you see that these startups have to be global. Mm-hmm. If you take TeamLeader, for instance, CRM-oriented mm-hmm. in there, they're expanding very quickly into Spain, Germany, they opened an office in Germany. Because in their market, you have to have somebody. And staying outside Belgium is key for them, not mm-hmm. just focusing on Belgium.
And like Wuhank, yeah.
Wuhank is a good example. Engager, often you will find, truly, that these startups, I don't know Wuhank by the numbers, but I would not be surprised that more than 90% of their business is from outside Belgium.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's typical an environment that die local or go global. Mm-hmm. So that's edtech. Number 3, That's unique for Belgium. In top five, we have manufacturing. We are still a very industrial country. And you look, if you look into manufacturing, it happens there as well. Manufacturing is going very quickly, Industry 4.0, digital factories, Internet of Things, so all this kind of stuff, robots, for instance, are happening in manufacturing. That's also unique to Belgium. For the time being, we are also unique there compared to other countries. Number four is fintech. Everything around financial disruption, if you like, right? All the companies scaring banks and insurance companies today. Belgium has a long history of fintech. We were the first country who has ATM machines except the UK.
So after interesting.
The UK, yeah, we have the first ATM network, you can really, in the 70s, take money out from a machine.
But like the chip comes from France, right?
Oh, that's possible.
Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Ah,
so the chip has been created by a French guy, but
okay. I didn't know that. Okay.
The fintech. So, and compared to London, then fintech is really the thing in Belgium?
Fintech, I think London is globally the number one. It's also the financial city as such, so it's by far number one. Yeah. After London, we have a chance. Don't forget, Julie, there is here a lot of knowledge. People, SWIFT is here. It's like all the bank transactions go to SWIFT. Euroclear is here. MasterCard is here.
Wow, yeah.
So all this knowledge of fintech is also available in Belgium. And you can see that in the numbers that they're also doing very well. Two initiatives being launched end of last year. One is Explore, which is an ecosystem around fintech, just launched last year. And the bank ING launched ING Fintech Village, focusing on fintech. There's a lot of things happening over there. Last but not least is everything around human resource. It's number five. The first time for me was a surprise, because I didn't really expect this to be number five. But if you think about it, Julie, if you're a human resource today, recruitment is online. Assessments can happen online. Training can be online. A lot of things happening by software. So even this department is adapting towards new reality.
That's true.
And that's why it's an opportunity. Interesting enough, nobody claimed a domain in Belgium. The others, I mean, people focusing on that, really focusing, creating a lot of things. Health tech, there is Health House opened in Leuven. Nick Vlaanderen has a site in Ghent, has a site in Genk focusing on that. But human resource, interesting enough, nobody claimed that domain.
It's okay. Like a location, you mean?
Correct.
Where to, like, together.
To get them together, to support them, to accelerate the ecosystem, to create a community, like a meetup group coming together. Nobody claimed that. It's like the ugly duck, right? So that's an invitation.
Absolutely.
It has a lot of potential that nobody sees right now. Yet, the top five is only 31%. So a very broad, diverse ecosystem.
Okay.
If we deep one level deeper and look to the activities we have, the business models that we have as startups, number one is not a surprise, it's a marketplace model. Internet is the new middleman. We bring two parties together and they match them, eBay, if you like, kind of model. So also here you see it coming back. Number two is typical Europe, I think. Hardware is driven by Europe. If you look to technology like Arduino, came from Italy, Raspberry Pi came from the UK. It's really typical technology, hardware technology coming from Europe, not from the US. So we are more innovative there than the US today.
Yeah, really.
Indeed. And it look, you see that we, being an engineer country, we still have that history as well here. Number three, it's not really a surprise, big data. Right? It's a big thing anyway. It gets a lot of focus and a lot of startups are building their products on top of that. I hope that the new measurements and the rules of open data in Belgium, it will only accelerate even more in the future. Four apps, still people building apps. And lastly, social media. To scale social media is very hard from Belgium. The last time we had a really successful company was back in 2010, Netlog, had 100 million users all over the world. It was the number one website in 7 European countries, but it's very hard to scale it from Europe.
So we just go back with the big data here in Europe. Isn't that difficult to, you know, to build up softwares about big data, because Europe is so protective in terms of privacy?
You're right. If it's data about consumers, we have... competitively, it's not a good position. I mean, the US has a better position. You can't build in Europe the same models like in the US. Just a fact. So indeed, the US has better cards in terms of privacy around users. So it's a priority over there. He is much more strict. You can see also, like, Everybody who is providing services in Europe get forced to have local service, local regulations. Germany is very strict on that. They forced Azure, Microsoft, to create really a center within Germany, just for Germany, because they're very strict. Mm-hmm. So indeed, it's not a competitive benefit to be in Europe from that point of view.
Okay.
At the same time, I can appreciate that they care about our privacy as well.
Yeah, that's true. We all do.
That's correct. So these five are 56%, so it's quite concentrated compared to the other one before.
Mm-hmm.
What you see here, Julie, is that the number of startups, which are by definition scale-ups, that have a branch outside Belgium. So 11% in Belgium. I would say it's rather low, can only grow in the future, I hope. The 11%, one-third of them open a branch in the US. Makes sense, big single market, right? Mm-hmm. Less regulation, opportunities for investors, open to startups, so that is quite normal. Then you see the countries, France, Netherlands, UK, Luxembourg, where we open a branch. What country do you think is missing?
Well, I guess Germany.
Exactly. It's surprising, Julie, that Germany is smaller than Luxembourg. How can that be?
Yeah.
Right? So there is a big market. We are B2B oriented. We are into manufacturing oriented. A number of things which are really relevant to the German market, yet we're not there. The assumptions I have is culture and language. Who speaks German today within Belgium? A very little group.
Really?
I believe so.
Okay.
Yes.
Because it's our third language.
Yes, in theory, but you have to be very local. You have to master the language. You have to present there. I think there's a gap and we don't see that. So we are focusing on the West. If you get that behind us, 1 hour from here, you can drive. You are in a big market. That's, I think, an opportunity we have to work on.
Okay, Germany.
Germany is the way to go. Go east, not west. So far, actually, we're doing very well, right? If you look at the numbers, a nice ecosystem in there. Let's look now from financial perspective.
Mm-hmm.
2014, all startups in Belgium raised 100 million euro, all together. The year after, last year, we went to 238 million.
Wow.
Yeah. Great, because we more than doubled.
Absolutely.
Deals also get better. If you look to 2014, we had 22 companies that raised at least 1 million euro. In 2015, we had 43 of them. Also that doubled. That's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, that's one round for one company in Silicon Valley.
Mm-hmm.
Even worse, it's one round of one company in Paris, or in London, or in Berlin,
yes,
or in Stockholm.
Okay? That's true.
So that's very small. I mean, compared to our talent and our potential and innovation power, this is to me very, very little.
So you think we think too small, we don't think big enough in Belgium?
Good question. I think in terms of our entrepreneurs, our people who are entrepreneurs, they might think big, and they think big, and have a vision, but you need to convince people to invest in you. So in our country, there's enough capital. It's amazing, but the money is here. We have 300 billion, or almost 400 billion, in our saving accounts, right? It's huge, yet it doesn't find its way to this group.
Okay, so they really need to go abroad.
Unfortunately, a number of them, especially when you look for the bigger rounds, you need to go abroad. Finding a million in Belgium is possible. I think this year, 50 companies will prove that it's possible,
mm-hmm.
but only 50. In my opinion, there's 4 or 5 times more than that who need that money. If you need 10 million in Belgium, success. Not a lot of companies will do that. So you need to go outside Belgium as of these bigger tickets.
Okay.
So that's, to me, a shame. We have talent.
Yeah.
It's all there. We have the entrepreneurs. We have the money, and yet we don't manage to bring the money.
Yeah, but you're going to explain about that later.
Go a bit deeper on that, yes,
yeah.
Indeed. These are the companies that have been acquired in 2015.
Mm-hmm.
They're 18. It's a very small number.
Mm-hmm.
Why is this important? If there is no deal flow, no investors will come and invest. So this number is low, it will be hard to find venture capital, right? So an indication of venture capital, this group is small. So that's related to each other, small number of deal flow also means small number of capital you will attract.
Mm-hmm.
So it's another sign that on that side of the ecosystem, we are underperforming big time. Here's another ugly and shocking slide, if you like. If you look to the Nasdaq, the Valhalla, to go public for technology companies, you can see that 2014, one company went there, materialized, to raise money. The time before that was 17 years ago.
That's shocking.
To me, it's shocking. The one before, we don't even going to say the name because it's still very sensitive and traumatic,
yeah.
The company that went down big time.
Yeah.
Let's benchmark that, Julie, against two small countries in the world, not big ones. You will see that Netherlands has 10 companies on the Nasdaq. So it's 10 times more. Netherlands is a bit bigger than Belgium. If you look to Israel, which is smaller than Belgium, 63 companies are on the Nasdaq. I understand it's a different ecosystem.
Yeah.
They're very strong in security and other things.
Mm.
Yet it shows you don't have to be big to do great.
That's true.
And that's to me.
That's a really go-getter, and we need to learn a lot about these guys.
Absolutely. Let's look now to locally. We have Euronext here in Brussels. These are the companies, technology companies in there, excluding biotech, of course, and life sciences, different ecosystem.
Mm-hmm.
You see that the last one who went here locally even is 2006. That's 10 years ago. So there's a long way to go for our companies to go to the next level as such. So coming to the question, knowing our strength, knowing our good points, what we are focusing on, also knowing the bad and ugly part of our ecosystem.
In Belgium, yeah.
In Belgium, everybody will sooner or later face the question, stay local,
go global.
Go global,
yeah.
Exactly. So here are, I believe every entrepreneur in technology will really struggle sooner or later. That's the difference between a startup and a starter. Typical discussion, what's a startup, what's not a startup? Think about opening a bakery, actually. It's not very difficult. You go, you take the map of Belgium, look to the population, look to the competition, take the optimal point, i.e. highest population, lowest competitors.
Mm-hmm.
If you open a bakery and your bread is a bit okay, you manage, you make a living, no problem. Why? It's an existing product for an existing market.
Mm-hmm.
Now, imagine we opening a bakery in China. Do you think it will work?
Well, with a lot of marketing, advertising, and
maybe.
Free tasting.
I don't know, maybe. Because it's a question mark, because we don't have a bread culture in China, it's a rice culture. So we don't know, right? We might test it out, but we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So now we changed only one parameter. It's a new market, and it's already a question mark. Startup is about new product, new market.
Mm-hmm.
It's extremely hard. But another difference between a startup and a starter. The bakery, you have customers within 5, 7, 8 kilometers maybe. You're not going to drive 50 kilometers for a bread.
Correct.
So it's local competition, right? But a startup, it goes global from day one. The moment you're online, you're global.
Mm-hmm.
So it also means you're competing global from day one. So staying local might be a dead pool. So you're forced to compete global from day one. And therefore, every tech startup will sooner or later face the question. So how do you answer this question, right? $1 million question.
So do you have some recipes for us?
We have some scenarios at least, yes,
okay.
Indeed. One way to look to that is to map out marketing potential for your product or your service
mm-hmm.
against access to resources. It's a very simple thing to
yeah.
do, but you can look into that. And then you have four possibilities. One is if it's low market potential, but you have great access to talent, at a reasonable price, you can go offshore. 8% of our companies are in that situation. You go to Romania, for instance, or Sri Lanka, develop the software.
Mm-hmm.
The other scenario is that you look into a low market potential against low access to resources. That's a market that you can try to serve remotely, only online. So you sign them up, you sell them, you do everything online. For instance, you might from Belgium not open a branch in Luxembourg, but you try to get this customer. You can call locally to a local number, you can email you, you can chat with them. So you offer your services there remotely.
Okay.
So Luxembourg will be a case that you can apply there.
Mm-hmm.
A third scenario is that you have a high market potential, access to a lot of talent, right? That's a perfect scenario to open a branch. I.e., you need marketing talent. It's harder to find in Belgium than in New York. Go to New York. One, you have access to talent, but you also have a great market.
Yeah, but it's very expensive as well.
Absolutely. That is why if you scale up, you very likely need also money. Mm-hmm. I will show some scenarios, give an idea how much you need. Mm. So you're right, this scenario might be the most expensive one. But it might be more expensive not to do that, because you will die.
Okay.
You pay a higher price.
Yeah, that's true.
But you're right, you need capital to do that.
Yeah.
It's very hard to bootstrap. Lastly, you might find high potential market, but hard to access resources, too little, too expensive. Right? You might work with partners. That's the other possibility that you can do. Partners are a great way of doing that.
Yeah.
Being in Silicon Valley is very expensive if you want to do it on yourself.
Yeah, and so you decrease the risk and also the investment.
Absolutely. Yeah. Partners are a great way. It doesn't work for every market,
but
it's potentially something you have to investigate.
Yeah, sure.
So these are four major scenarios. Now, that's one dimension, resource against market potential. The second thing you can do is try to look at from the needs that are in the market. And a simple way for your product and your service is look how often the problem is there, the need is there, the frequency, against how big the pain is, how deep is the problem.
Yeah.
Okay? An example of high pain, low frequency is shark bites. If you go to the sea here in Belgium and you swim, the chance that you get a shark bite is extremely small. It happens once in 100 years maybe, I don't know. But if you have that issue, you have a really big problem. You're dying. Okay? So you found a big problem, but in a very low frequency.
Okay.
But if you found it, somebody would pay a lot of money to fix it, right?
Mm-hmm.
A problem of high frequency, low level of pain is mosquito bites. Every summer we get mosquitoes in Belgium.
Yeah.
It's annoying, they wake you up at night, it's itching in the morning, but you can live with it, it's okay.
Okay,
right?
You can cope with it. You can
cope with it, yeah. Doing nothing is a good alternative,
okay.
Right? So that's the two dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
And you can try to find a high pain, high frequency is normally the biggest market potential.
Mm.
So you can map out countries and look from that point of view. Obviously, in this picture now, you can see that the UK, which has high pain, high frequency, mm-hmm. is the first market you want to tackle. But then it becomes more difficult because you can go for Brazil in this example, where you have high pain level, or you can go to the US, which has a higher frequency level.
Mm-hmm.
What's the trade-off? In my view, you better go for Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
Why? If you have higher pain level, you have quicker adoption. What you need is growth and adoption. So in this case, it's better, although the market is bigger in the US, to go to Brazil.
Okay, so it's a mixture with the pain, it's a mixture with culture, with the language,
that's correct.
Habits,
that's correct.
Market space and potential, okay?
Correct. But market adoption, the speed of it is the most important parameter. Go to the market which is adopting the quickest, not the one who will take more time. Even if it's a bigger market, like in this case, US will take more time. It's maybe, it is a bigger market in this graph, but in this case, Brazil might be a better choice.
Okay.
So market adoption is the key element. That's one way to map out,
mm-hmm.
look to your users, who you have, how they're reacting, and see what you can test there.
Okay.
That's a second simple framework.
So doing a lot of landing pages and
different languages.
See how the people write. Yeah, okay.
Correct. Localization can do from here. Now, let's look into different playbooks. First playbook might be stay in Belgium. The most simple thing, you're in Belgium, stay in Belgium. But it requires that the local market is big enough to make you sustainable. Right? If you cannot have enough market here to make you sustainable, you have to move.
Mm-hmm.
That's the first condition. Second is the benefit of this model. You don't need a lot of capital. You might be able to bootstrap it. You might find 300,000 euros in seed capital. It's enough to do that.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need a big amount of venture capital.
Mm-hmm.
That's a benefit. But it also means that you cannot attract VC money. If you don't need it, that's fine in there. The only price you might pay if you are in a winner takes all market,
mm-hmm.
you might get beaten when the big boys are coming.
Mm-hmm.
Example in Belgium is Jump, a local tax and ride sharing app that needs to compete against Uber.
Mm-hmm.
Very hard. You cannot stay local in that model,
mm-hmm.
right? So that's an example where somebody wants to stay local, but you cannot because the global player will take it over.
Yeah.
So that's the key thing. However, even in that scenario, once your growth slows down, you can consider going international or additional markets. So at any moment in time, when you feel like, okay, I'm thinking about Belgium, but you feel like growth is slowing down, you reach your maximum, you need to think about next step.
Okay.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Other segment in the market within Belgium or looking outside?
Okay, so...
You can't escape.
Right? Yeah.
The question will come up sooner or later. This strategy is not based on exits. You want to create a cash cow, not cash cow to bootstrap. It's a different mindset, and therefore you don't need even venture capital. It has pros, but also a lot of dangers. Mm-hmm. A second scenario might be to lock in the three biggest markets in Europe, i.e. be dominant in the UK, in France, and Germany. Mm-hmm. These are the biggest markets that we have in Europe. It might be a different market for your product, but in general, these are the three major economies. This requires money. It requires a Series A and Series B. It means you need to go over 10 million. Often, you will find European investors to do that. Because you're European focused, you can also raise money within Europe. Likely, you will raise Series A in Belgium and Series B outside Belgium. Mm-hmm. So you do like 1, 2.5 million, you can do in Belgium. Once you go higher than that, very likely you will have outside capital from Belgium. But given the strategy, that's possible. An example is Mailjet, started in France. Strategy was to take UK, France, and Germany. We raised 60 million so far to lock in these three countries. That's the whole plan. Mailjet is from eFounders, which also has a Belgian founder, Quinten Ekmans from Brussels. The challenge here is that product market fit is per country different. What works in France doesn't mean it will also work in Germany.
Absolutely.
Or in the UK.
Yeah.
So you have to find three times product market fit. One time is hard, three times is really hard.
So have a local team.
Indeed. That's actually, especially in France and Germany, they're buying also more local, they're local oriented. Even UK, big market, you better be local. Mm. This is why you need so much money. Because you need to be on the ground. Mm-hmm. So that's indeed true. You already came to the conclusion. You need a local office in these three countries. And it takes between 3, at least up to 7, sometimes even 10 years to be there. It's a long time thing.
To be there, like break even or?
Not in terms of break even, to be, because it might be early or later break even, but to be dominant. I.e., if you want that market, you have to talk to me. You lock that in. Let's say you create an app where you can book restaurants, okay? Dinners at restaurants.
Yeah.
Fine. You take these three markets. Let's say that an American booking app wants to come to Europe. Mm. There is no other way than talk to you. You have the key to these major markets. If you only have Belgium and maybe a little bit of Luxembourg and Netherlands, they can do it themselves.
Mm-hmm.
If you look on the three countries, you force them to talk to you.
Yeah, okay.
It'll be successful applied by Rocket Internet, for instance, right? They're selling their eBay version and et cetera. So that's playbook number two. Playbook number three is scaling from Belgium. Mm-hmm. Stay in Belgium, but you try to take over the world from Belgium. That is a good plan if it's a local ecosystem, i.e. if you're in B2B. You are into manufacturing, health tech, fintech, hardware, things we are strong in, it might be a good plan. If you are in things which are consumer-oriented, perhaps it's going to be very hard to do that. So consider who you are, and if you can find a local ecosystem here to support you in terms of advice, expertise, experience, but also venture capital.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a key thing. Very likely, you want to go that path and take over the world, you have to go behind Series B. A, B, keep going. Maybe you will end up in IPO. And very likely, you need international investors. You will not be able to find this kind of money in Belgium.
Yeah, sure.
So that's a challenge, because international investors might force you to open a branch with their country.
Yeah.
US investors, to invest in a Belgium local entity, it's hard.
Mm-hmm.
So you can already feel a conflict. You want to take over the world, scale from Belgium, but you feel already constraints.
Yeah, but you can have smart money as well. So they can help you also building up your business abroad.
I think it's the best thing to do, Julie. Yeah. Indeed. Typical, it's a business model that requires boots on the ground. It needs you to be local present in terms of sales, support, maybe follow the sunk capabilities, 24-hour support kind of thing. So all this kind of stuff might require that. However, this scenario in Belgium, there may be 10, 20 people who have really this experience. So I think the point you make, Julie, about smart money, you need that. Not a lot of people have this experience in Belgium. Mm-hmm. So you need not just money, but smart money in this scenario. How do you do that? This is also a good scenario to think about partners. Maybe don't do everything yourself. Try to work with partners to grow faster and invest less in there. Don't have to be in every market. And think about a horizon of 7 to 10 years to make an exit or an IPO. Scenario number four, playbook number four, move away from Belgium. Don't stay here, right? It's bleeding that I say that, but okay. In B2C, market-driven consumer services, bon chance to do it in Belgium. It's very hard to do that. Especially in the pay-never cash flow model, it means that you create something which is so big that someday somebody will pay for it, like Facebook. You need to have 100 million of users. This is almost impossible outside Silicon Valley. Even in the US, being in Chicago or being in Florida, it's not going to work. You have to move to Silicon Valley for this model. So that's the same for us. We don't have a local ecosystem. We don't have the money kind of thing to do that. Forget about 10 million, it will be maybe even 100 million. So you need to go international and find smart monies, and you have to move your companies. But make sure you decide on market potential and access to talent and capital. It might be China for you. There is a Belgian startup who made a new way for Chinese people to give in the characters on the mobile phone. It's, of course, you're forbidden in China then. So it doesn't have to be the US. It might be another place.
Okay. Emoticons, yeah. Okay.
Indeed. Emoticons. That's absolutely right. One thing is, you should not go with an ID and try to convince people. Nobody is interested in your ID. Find product market fit for the local market, the target market you want to go, and go convince them with that story to do that. So that's the key thing. So don't go with an ID to Silicon Valley. Go with something that works in the US to convince them to invest in you.
Okay, go first there, invest.
With something working, not with an ID. So make a prototype,
Yeah, sure.
People think they have an idea, they can go to Silicon Valley.
And you don't have to start here. You can go directly there.
Don't start here. It's not benefit. It's make sure that you experiment from Belgium. Once you feel there's something in there, maybe even landing page with 1,000 email addresses, then move there. But don't start something in Belgium.
Okay.
It doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Take a one-way ticket and leave. So that's the major playbooks that you can apply. Of course, it's always a combination, but it makes you think about what are the possible scenarios for myself. I also like to give some practical advice. First of all, the market with the fast adoption is your prime target, always. Not the one who has the biggest potential, because that's like boiling the ocean, right? Every startup has one thing that you need to focus on, is growth. And growth is what will bring you value in the future. Think about other countries. Maybe your target market is Turkey, or maybe it is Nigeria. It's a very big market. Maybe it's Brazil. Don't only think US, don't only think Germany or the UK. You look further than just the usual suspects in terms of countries. Is there any country you like to go?
Brazil. Okay. Oh, Turkey is a great country, though.
Indeed. Yeah. There's also a Turkish community that you can leverage.
Yeah, young community.
Absolutely.
Nigeria, yeah, of course.
It's a very big market.
Yeah, and Africa, and go there also to develop things.
Absolutely. You know, you do something good for the world and make it also business.
Absolutely,
and not just being the next Silicon Valley playbook, right? So be different. If you want to work with partners, if that's what you want to do, make sure that the price is high enough that they can also make money. So pricing is crucial if you want to work with partners. If your margin is too low, nobody will work with you because they want to make money as well. Right? So pricing is crucial working with partners. I wrote a whole book about this, actually.
Yeah.
If you want to do 24/7 support, that's damn hard. I mean, if you're like in Belgium, for instance, and you want to build that, it's almost impossible. So follow the Sun capabilities, work with locals, partners, or be also local there. Try to test markets in a very cheap way. Try to do localized landing pages, see if it gets traffic, and where people are reacting, how they like it. It's a very easy way to test the market in there. I think landing page is in 2 hours done. So there you go. If you want to expand, don't forget to protect your domain, .com, the name, the branding, that you don't get into problems once you arrive.
Europe, international,
indeed.
US.
Indeed. So very crucial for the target markets. Try to localize the content, interface, your marketing, the payment methods. People forget that. Not everybody is paying the same way as you pay here, right? To master that is crucial. If you take booking.com, you're supporting more than 100 currencies, languages, number of ways of paying. It's really competitive advantage to do that. That's a nice one.
yeah, I really like that one.
If you like a certain target country, why don't you, if you go to a conference, go there, any conference, and you go on holidays, spend there, because then you can have a feeling with the culture, you might run into people, so it's really like a very practical thing.
Yeah, you're right, it's good for the expenses.
Indeed, it's a fiscal benefit too, you're right, Julie. Other thing you can do is, if you're in Belgium, hire somebody from a target country. You have, I mean, it's a very society, you can find everybody here, right? In there, hire somebody. They get them on board, it's good for diversity, but you also get things you don't know, like, oh, it's not going to work in my country because of X, Y, Z. So bring the country here, basically, right? Mm. And in Belgium, you can do that. There's another very important element that you can you can use being here in Belgium, or important elements, is, first of all, because we're such a small country, usually, we think much more global. Mm-hmm. I mean, we are so small that you have to think global.
Yeah.
That's a benefit from day one. Second is, there's a difference between the US and Europe. If we raise 1 million, it means we do that to scale up outside Belgium. Mm-hmm. If we raise 1 million or Series A in the US, it's to take the US. So you have 2-3 years time before they go to Series B, before they come to Europe. Mm-hmm. So that's a big benefit that you can use to take Europe while they are still busy trying to take the US. Mm-hmm. So international expansion starts at Series A in Belgium and Series B in the US.
Okay.
So that's an important delta that you can use. We have a very fragmented market, different languages, different cultures, it all comes together, the Latin world and the Nordic world comes here together. Mm-hmm. It's an opportunity to learn what it means to localize, right? While in the US you don't have that. Mm-hmm. Everything around talent is here. We have talent, we have capabilities, technologies, access, we all can do that. There's also much more growing confidence. And again, thanks to initiatives like Beta Group, that people say, hey, it's possible, we can do that. We can really become a global giant out of Belgium. It is possible. And lastly, I'm very proud of our ecosystem and the community. It's amazing, right? You're in the middle of it. You know that.
Yeah. Yeah, we're really lucky here to be supported, and also by the government, by everybody, private, public. So we need to take that opportunity here first and then go abroad with that.
I agree. You can also get support. The number of organizations, talk to the export agencies, they help you there. They are the local embassies. For instance, you go to a country, let's say going to Thailand, you want to meet customers, ask the ambassador to use the embassy as a place to see them.
It's true.
It's very impressive, it's free, and it's a good thing. So use the local representative of Belgium as well. There is Beta Group, who has a number of missions focused on certain markets. There's a number of other initiatives to help you. If you go to the US, New York, BelChamp is there. I have a long history in it. There is, every country has a chamber of commerce that you can use. They were very happy to try to get you to that country and subsidize.
Absolutely. We don't have to hesitate to go and bail to these doors.
Absolutely.
They're always open. Yeah.
Indeed, they are there to help you, actually.
Yeah.
And a very important thing is there's a lot of B-tech startups that really are in the country there.
Yeah.
So if you know that this B-tech startup is there, growing there, contact them.
Give a call.
In there. I mean, it's just in the last couple of years that this happens.
Yeah.
And I think with this slide, we're almost finished for the session.
Okay, thank you so much, Omar.
It was a pleasure.
And it was really interesting. So see you next time, and thank you for following us
on
Beta Group YouTube channel. Bye-bye, guys.
Thank you.